In this segment, I will demonstrate how to create a responsive design layout with images. We will follow the mobile-first design approach. One layout is a single column container. We will use that on narrow width devices. For wider width devices, we use a two column container. We also cover responsive design choices for images to accommodate different device viewports. This includes flexible image sizing and their layout positioning. Finally, we learn how to use the link element to nest CSS media queries. First, let's look at the completed web page rendered at the target widths. I'm going to use Firefox's responsive design view. This is the base view of the page. It is a single column layout. There is the main page content that includes a related image. Then there is some featured content with icons. Now we can move up to the minimum smartphone width. We have the same layout as the base view. You see that the main content image size increases to fit the width. Also, when a target screen width is detected, we are changing the background color for testing purposes. Now rotate it to landscape. The main content image now floats to the right and is constrained to a smaller size. The single column layout remains in place. The other content grows to fill the viewport width. Now we have the minimum portrait tablet width. Here the content is presented in a two-column layout. Interestingly, the image returns to dominate the top of the main content. Keep in mind that the design choices drive the work. Switching to a landscape tablet view, the layout stays at two columns, but the main content image flows back to the right with a reduced size. This layout holds as we move into the laptop and desktop screen widths. For these views, the page width gets constrained at 1200 pixels. Also, a background image fills the empty viewport margins. Now we can switch over to the starting web page. All the responsive views show in a single column layout. Each fills the screen width. We have not added the images yet. The constraint on the page width is in place for laptops and desktops. First, let's look at the starting files. In the practice file, we have four external CSS files linked. One is the base CSS file. The others are for each group of screen width targets. These files are selected based on their media attribute. The content is structured with one container div element. There are four inner containers, one for the page header, one for the page content using the div ID'd as main. It contains a single article. The article has a level 2 header and paragraph elements. The third holds feature content in the div element ID'd as featured. The featured content contains three articles. Each of those have a level 3 header element and a paragraph element. And the last container is for the page footer. This is the base CSS file. It addresses basic styling properties such as fonts, font color, font sizing, background colors, margins, and padding. For the 320 breakpoint CSS, we just have a background color change. At the 768 breakpoint, a few styling sizes are increased. That takes advantage of the larger screen space. The last CSS breakpoint is for the 1024 width. Here, the page width is constrained at 1200 pixels. Also, the page is centered within the viewport. Our first task is to handle images for our responsive layouts. So let's start with the main content image. In the snippets file on line 107, we have the HTML ready to go. This is the image for the main content article. Copy that line, and we can insert that on line 24 in the practice HTML file. Put it after the P element. The image resolution is 400 pixels by 400 pixels. Save, and let's see how this appears. Start out at the laptop and desktop responsive view. As the screen width is reduced, the image maintains its height and width. And you can see this is not desirable at the smaller widths. So we need to adjust size and positioning for various views. We can use the one image and just scale it to fit its containers. This is the flexible image approach. Generally, you target one dimension to optimize the resolution. In our case, that is 400 by 400 pixels. But if scaling degrades the image quality or the design requires cropping, you may need multiple copies of the image. Then you can use media queries to target where they are used. We will make our base CSS use the flexible image scaling approach. Then we adjust that for different layout needs. In this snippet's files on lines 110 and 111, we have the CSS for flexible image scaling. The height is auto, and the width is typically 100%. Then insert that in the base CSS file on line 15, save. Check this in the web browser, first at the base, next the width breakpoint at 320 portrait. The image is slightly over half its width. Now the 320 landscape, the 768 portrait breakpoint. The image width now exceeds 600 pixels. Now at the 768 landscape, the image is now over 900 pixels wide. And finally into the laptop desktop breakpoint, the image is scaled up close to 1200 pixels wide. Consistently, the image expands to fill the available width. You can see we need to contain the image width. We will do that when we make the layout changes for the larger screens. Before we do that, let's make the image stand out from the background and include the icons for the featured content. In the snippets file on lines 114 to 121, we have the CSS ready. We are targeting images within the main content article elements. Rather than have the image appear inline, we will make it behave as a block element. This will work well for the single column layout on narrow width screens. Let's copy this and try it. Paste on line 35 of the base CSS file. Save. Reload. The background shows up as expected for the base, as well for landscape views, and all the way out to the laptop desktop breakpoint. Now we also have some small icons for the featured content. In the snippets file, we have the first one to try. Copy line 124. Insert that after the P element on line 32. Save. In the web browser, we see that the base CSS IMG selector for flexible image sizing is applied, so we need to override that. These icons only appear in the featured article element, so we can target them in the CSS. In the snippets file on line 127, we have a selector targeting that. The IMG tags within the featured article elements. The selector will override the default flexible image sizing. It also floats the images to the left. Copy through to line 131. In the base CSS file, we can put that on line 48. Save and reload. In the web browser, we see the icon is back to its defined size, and we can check another responsive view to see that override holds. Also, the main content image sizing still remains flexible. We have two more glyph icons to add and a Creative Commons link. In the snippets file, copy line 134. Insert that after the P element on line 36 in the practice file, and one more on line 137 in the snippets file. Paste in the practice file after the P element on line 40. These glyph icons are under Creative Commons, requiring a link to the author's site, and we made some digital modifications. So on line 140 of the snippets file, we have the link to cover that. Add that after the footer section on line 46 of the practice file. Now we can save and check these changes. There are the icons and the Creative Commons link. So far, we have a single column layout for all viewports. We want to keep that until we get to the 768 width breakpoint. There we will switch to a two-column layout. But first, look at the 320 width breakpoint in landscape orientation. The main image sizing needs another approach. Just making the image narrower is going to leave wide margins, but we can float it right wrapped by the text content. To do that, we will need to return to an inline element, but only for the landscape orientation. In the snippets file, starting on line 143, we have a media query targeting landscape orientation. It contains a selector targeting the IMG element in the main content section. The properties return the IMG element to inline and floats it to the right. This overrides the default flexible width sizing of IMG elements. We're going to place this in the 320 pixel width CSS file. So copy lines 143 to 151. Add that on line 5 of the screen-min-320 CSS file. At first, this may appear to be nesting CSS media queries, but so far we do not have any CSS media queries. Rather, we only have the link elements media attribute. Link elements only load CSS files. we are now adding the first CSS media query. In a sense, we have a faux nesting of media query rules. This is a benefit of using the link element to handle the screen width detection. Then we can use the CSS media queries for further design needs. CSS media queries nesting support is added in CSS 3, but as of this recording, is not reliably supported across web browsers. Save and check this out in the web browser. You can see we still have the single column layout, and the single column stays for the landscape orientation. The one difference is the main article image position and size. Also, the feature article icons remain unchanged. For the target width from 768 and larger, we're going to a two-column fluid layout. We will need to have the column widths to be percentages. The default box model sizing is content box. This sets properties to apply only to the inner content and excludes borders and padding. That makes percentage width computations difficult. We can change that by using border box for box sizing. This forces the width property to include padding and borders. In the snippets file, we have that change on lines 154 to 157. Add that on line 5 of the base CSS file. As you can see, this is the universal selector, so it is applied to all block elements. Pay attention to the image before we refresh. It has a width of 35% that computes to 152.317 pixels. That applies to the image and excludes borders and padding. We want the 35% width property to include those as well. Now refresh to apply the box sizing property set to border box. The image width reduces to 148 pixels. The borders and padding are now part of the 152.317 pixels. Back in the snippets file, we have the CSS for a two-column layout. Line 161 sets the main element to float left. The featured element is set to float right on line 165. Then the floats are cleared by the footer element. You can see we are using percents for the width property. With the border box sizing in place, we know borders and padding are included in those percentages. Copy lines 160 to 169. Add them on line 11 of the screen-min-768 CSS file. Now let's do a bottom-up review of the rendered page. The base stays single column. The smartphone width target also is single column in portrait view. In landscape, we float the image out to the right and reduce its size. Still single column layout. Now the tablet target width in portrait, we see the two column layout. And in landscape, the right floated image media query is carried forward. Finally, if we look at the laptop desktop breakpoint, the two column layout survives. Also, there are the constraints for the page container width. The laptop desktop page width constraints exposes a background. We can use that to show a background image. On line 172 of the snippets file, we have another CSS media query. It targets the 1200 pixel width breakpoint. In it, the body selector downloads a background image. We can copy and paste that media query on line 8 of the screen-min-1024 CSS file. Save and refresh. In the web browser, we see the background appear at the 1280 breakpoint. The background image bleed is not a planned creative. So let's change it. In the snippets file, line 177 resets the background color to the parent. Paste it on line 5 of the screen-min-1024 CSS file. Save and refresh, and that completes the changes.
Now you have a basic responsive layout example. It uses the mobile-first and flexible image approach. It uses link elements to target the screen width detection. Then it progressively adds styles as widths increase. Then within each width, we added media queries to handle specific needs, such as screen orientation and intermediate screen widths.